So I'm really pleased to be given the opportunity to present, let's say, a little bit in a provocative way, what generative AI, generative artificial intelligence, is doing in our everyday life, but especially with a view in the solar sector. I hope, and then maybe we can ask at the end, if we have the chance. I hope that all the people in assisting this talk today have played around with ChatGPT or similar tools, so that shouldn't come as a surprise. And even if you say no, I know that's not true, because this is common practice for students. And I think it's important that we start embracing this novelty that is coming into our lives. Some people, they are looking at it with curiosity, some others they see it as a threat. But it's important that we really start thinking about how it could be an opportunity for us. So without any further ado, I take you through this short description that I was asked to provide. And when I thought about it, I think it's important maybe not just to give a view in absolute terms, because I have my opinion about this topic, but maybe this opinion differs from other people working in the field. So maybe at the end, I would like to hear from the participants if they believe that AI will indeed disrupt the solar sector, or maybe not. So let's see how convincing I can be in either ways. So we have this new power player in around, especially in the, let's say, with focus of today's talk in the PV industry. So is something artificial intelligence that has evolved beyond just a future prospect, and now it could represent some revolutionary changes. It could reshape the solar energy landscape. It could bring new business operation and efficiency, or maybe not. So let's see. I will try during the presentation to give you some examples on how AI could be used in the solar sector. Before we start, I think it's important that we differentiate between what we could broadly divide into predictive AI and generative AI. So when we talk about artificial intelligence, per se, it's not something new. Let's say, I mean, if some of you has been studying or working with machine learning techniques, like neural networks and so on, this is something that in the solar sector, but not only in the solar sector, has been around for ages. I would say more than a decade. So this is something that is used in forecasting, for example, or in let's say in trying to compare expected behavior versus measured behavior. So there is nothing new, let's say, in terms of predictive AI. What is really what the game changer is the so-called generative AI. So something that, for example, is represented by ChatGPT. So when we look at predictive AI, this is, as I said, is a set of tools that we've been dealing with for years now. So you can use it to analyze historical data. You can use it to make predictions about future events or trends. What are the key features? It's data-driven. It relies on statistical models and machine learning algorithms, and some applications could be forecasting, failures detection, and in smart energy systems. If we look at generative AI instead, generative AI is a type of AI that learns from data to generate new content or solutions that did not exist before. And what is really interesting is that it is trying to mimic creativity of us, so of people, and is accessible to everyone. This is another key feature. So whilst the ability of using machine learning techniques, it means that you need to be some sort of an expert in data analysis and so on. The accessibility of generative AI is in the hands of everyone, because it can speak your language. It can also adapt the language to make sure that you can understand better the answer of a specific question. So the key technologies is what is typically called generative adversarial networks or transformer models. And the application for PV, there are yet to explore. So before taking you through what generative AI could do in the solar sector, I think it's important for you to understand how solar assets, solar PV plants are managed, also by introducing some advanced management concepts. And then maybe it will become also easier to understand if all the steps or only some of these steps can be, let's say, taken over by AI. So if we look at the value chain of a PV project, for the next few slides, I'm using, concepts taken from an Horizon 2020 EU-funded project called Trust PV that I have the honor to coordinate. So if we look at the value chain of a PV project and we go from the initial idea, let's say, which requires investment to the commissioning, we see that the important phases are the testing, the design, the engineering, the procurement and construction. Then we go through the operational phase together with the grid connection. And at the end, we go towards what is called the commissioning if you decide to dismantle the PV plant, or repowering if you decide to, let's say, upgrade or update your existing asset. So along this value chain, you have several mitigation measures that needs to be included. This type of mitigation measures, they are there during the design phase to reduce the number of failures of PV components in the field. This can be called preventative mitigation measures. And then you have mitigation measures that you need to use when your asset is operational, in terms of data-driven, mitigation measures based on monitor data and based on field inspections. So you can see that along this value phase, this value chain, there are several steps that where human intervention is required. So what is a data-driven quality management? So I mentioned that you have PV plant monitoring. So you monitor the electrical and meter data to try to understand how your PV plant is working. And you have operators going in the field to do field inspection to check the state of health of your asset. When you put together these two concepts and you start thinking about the digitalization of the process, you have to deal with, for example, the creation of digital twins of your asset. So you want to geolocalize the different components of your asset, so where your PV modules are, your inverter, your transformer, and so on. You want to make sure that because you are dealing with different IT platforms, so imagine that you have an IT platform for monitoring data, you have an IT platform for the ticketing of all the field intervention, you have an IT platform as an asset manager, you would like to make sure that all these IT platforms are interoperable. And then you need to start thinking about some metrics that can calculate the impact of your mitigation measures and everything that is happening in your asset. So you can, by putting these two things together, you can essentially have optimized operation and maintenance strategies. And you can then think about new contracts. For example, if you are the owner of a PV power plant, you can have new contracts with whoever is providing a service in terms of operation and maintenance, and you can start thinking about decision support systems. We will come back to that. So this looks like a rather complicated flow, a stream of data, but it's to show you how it would look like right now if you had to apply, let's say, state-of-the-art workflows to put together the information you have. So on the left-hand side, you have all the information coming, data coming from your monitoring platform. So you measured your electrical data, you measure your meteor data, you put everything together, and you can use it to do fault detection and to calculate, for example, if you have energy loss in your asset. Then on the other side, you have everything that comes from maintenance tickets. So you have the operators going into the field, they write down on in a log, in an history log, what they saw, what they did. And when you put these things together, you can essentially try to calculate some metrics that we have introduced called cost priority number that can calculate the impact, the economic impact of a failure happening in the field, which is due to the downtime caused by the failure and the cost of repairing the failure. So you see that you have a mix of, let's say, tools, digital tools, a mix of phases where you need human intervention. You need to have the need to make sure that these platforms can talk to each other, because if you have to do it by hand, it becomes very expensive. So this is an example of a digital tool integration where you can really geolocalize each component. By clicking on a component, you can see the history of the why the component was selected, if there was an inspection related to the component, and so on. This is something that now is becoming more and more state of the art in stakeholders involved in operation and maintenance of PV assets, where, for example, the operator has a tablet or they use their phone to track all the interventions in to make sure that the whole process is digitalized. But again, there is still a need to human intervention and let's say the need for a person to be in the field. So what are the key, let's say, the key components of this process? We mentioned already several of them. I would just add three. One is the need also to have a common dictionary or common nomenclature. For example, if you have operator A going into the field, they might call a specific problem with a, in a certain way, and then you have operator B detecting a exactly the same issue but calling in a different way. You might lose information if you don't have a common nomenclature. Then what you can have is suggestions on actions. Suggestion on actions means that you could have a decision support system running behind, suggesting what is the best course of action for you to fix a problem. And then you can also link everything with health and safety and skills management. So this is already, we're already talking about really advanced ways of managing an asset. So this is already something that is not generally happening in the field. So in terms of field inspections, you have different diagnostic techniques that are done mostly manually in the field. This, for example, is electroluminescence. You could use drones to try to automatize the process, to speed up the process, to have a high throughput. You can start looking into in-field robotics, so robots that, let's say, they stay permanently at the asset, they go back and get and recharge when they need. And then you can start thinking about, the message I'm trying to give here is to give you some ideas on how all processes can be partly or entirely driven by machines, let's say. So we go back for a second to the decision support systems before I can show you some concrete example on how AI could slowly take over some of these steps. So when you think about this decision support system, you need to make sure that you digitalize your asset entirely. So we mentioned this concept of digital twin. Digital twin means that if you're not familiar with the concept, you create a digital version of your asset already, if possible, already during the planning, the early design. And this is particularly important because it also allows you to avoid loss of information when you move from design to engineering to the operational phase and so on. Then you need to implement a common nomenclature. We developed this what we called a risk matrix. Risk matrix means that for each component and subcomponent, we have assigned a certain nomenclature. And this is very important, as I mentioned before, when you have a ticketing platform, to make sure the operator can select from a drop-down menu what the issue is, instead of having like a free form where to write, let's say, how they assess the failure and what they've done. So to really minimize the issues related to human error in transcribing exactly what they've done in the field. And then once you have a digital asset, you went to the field, you identify an issue, you need to be guided through in terms of the solution to solve that specific issue in the field. We called it a solution matrix. And this can be through advanced monitoring or semi-automatic inspection techniques. So you have detected a failure through these different possible ways, and you want to solve it, and you will find the decision support system can help the operator in providing a possible solution. And then at the end, you can calculate a metric. And based on all the process, you can update what is called a knowledge base. So you create a knowledge inside the workflow that will be able to tell you in the next instance if the course of action that you have taken in the past is the best course of action or if it can be improved. So ultimately, this decision support system should suggest in an autonomous way, based on statistics and previous field experience, the most effective solution. And here, we already opened the door to the use of AI. So the big question now, after I've taken you, and of course, if you have questions about it later on, please don't hesitate. After I've taken you to a typical, let's say, workflow of limited on operation maintenance, but there are different workflows that happens in managing a PV asset. The question that we need to ask ourselves is, can artificial intelligence drive entire frameworks or only specific steps? So if we look from, let's say, a specific workflow that takes us from the predicted expected values, let's say identification of failures in the fields and all the way through reporting, we could try to summarize this in the workflow that you see in this slide. And if we go through step by step, we can see how AI can help in each single step. So we have outliers detection. So outliers detection is predictive AI, essentially. So you can use machine learning methods, but also more sophisticated methods to check the difference between what you are expected to see in your monitor, in your monitoring platform, compared to what you are actually measuring. And by doing that, you can detect outliers. This can be done in a real-time analysis. You can use it for fault detection. So from minor system hiccups to major faults, the models could make sure that nothing is actually that you don't miss, let's say, important information. And the final objective is that these anomalies, they need to be detected swiftly because you want to reduce the downtime. So you want to reduce the time that the asset is underperforming. Then you look at the failure prediction. So you have a predicted power, for example, generated by your system, and you comparing with the real power values. And you can use a sophisticated failure prediction framework, not only to, let's say, to predict, but also to predict the occurrence of failures. So before they actually happened. This is a little bit of the holy grail in predictive monitoring, because you have statistically, you have so much data available that you could potentially think that you could, based on the monitoring of several parameters, you could try to see if some behavior could potentially lead to a failure and intervene in the field before the failure happened. So here we are not even talking about reducing downtime, it's really, we are talking about avoiding downtime. But then we move to reporting. So it's here where you have the very first, let's say, disruptive innovation thanks to generative AI, thanks to the use of large language models. Because the use of large language models based, for example, on ChatGPT can generate reports automatically done. So imagine that you have a system that can automatically generate the history of an issue, saying, look, the monitoring system detected this failure. An operator was sent to the field. The operator decided to follow precise instruction, or the operator decided to use their own knowledge to fix a specific failure. And then based on the final outcome, you can, let's say, give a feedback to the operator by saying, yes, you did well, your course of action was correct, or I'm putting down I'm exaggerating, or it could say, you should have listened to me. The good thing is that here you can really, you need to, you have the possibility to tailor the reporting depending on your operator. You can also take into consideration cultural differences between operators. So the AI can be trained to make sure that it doesn't use a language that is perceived as confrontational by the operator, and so on. So reporting is the very first disruptive element by using AI, because at the moment most of the reporting still rely a lot on manual intervention. And in the reporting system, you can then play around and see what happens when you try to do profiling of your operators. You can try to provide some questions. You can see on these two examples without going through all the, let's say, the details, also because they are difficult to read. You can start classifying behaviors, and you can identify which operators are potentially the best operator for a specific type of failures in the field, and so on. So here, of course, we open up a big, huge question mark in terms of the way the AI should not manipulate people, let's say, the way they work, and so on. So everything needs to be fully transparent. So if you transparent towards the operators, meaning that they need to know that if you use this type of AI service, they need to know that this is happening. So just for you, if you are interested, for example, the Commission approved the AI Act in Europe, where they clearly state the ethical repercussion of the use of AI tools when you are dealing with people. So the second question is that, can AI become fluent in Solare language? Can AI become an expert, or do they always need the presence of operators? So what AI can do is quite effectively is clustering information. So you can, for example, feed all the data that you have for maintenance logs to AI, and AI can start clustering behavior. For example, here, clustering behavior like the PV panels are suffering from thermal cycling related wear and tear. The PV panels suffer from efficiency drops in temperature conditions and so on. So, and because they are leveraging on the use of large language model, this type of AI, they talk like us. So it's possible to have a dialogue. It's also easier to query because you don't have to be an expert in query. You can just ask a normal question, like you would ask a normal question to a colleague, and AI can provide an answer. So how would it look if we go back to the example of the reporting? You can imagine that you have different AI agents where each agent is skilled in doing different things. These AI agents, they interact with a detection system. So they look at they manage directly the monitoring platform. They look at there, they detect a deviation, and then they analyze and they decipher the results, and they can automatically produce reports, and they can simplify the comprehension for the operators. And they can provide, let's say, suggestions. So you're basically here, we're basically talking about a multi-agent architecture, and it would be a fully independently AI operated system, from the data analysis to the decision making, and so on. And this, of course, as the provided that the system is reliable, you can minimize human error and you can streamline processes. So what does it mean that the AI agents are particularly skilled? So you can create agents that are skilled, for example, in data science. The other agent would be skilled in maths. And then the other agent could be the supervisor. And these agents, they can independently talk to each other. And if we take this example, the data scientist, so this agent is trained to look what a data scientist, to do what a data scientist would be doing. So looking into data, looking at patterns, predicting future outcomes, and so on. So what is the different array of services that can be provided? So why I decided to put these four different people in this slide, because the thing is that this is something that I mentioned before as well. Being generative AI based on language models, they can talk to different stakeholders, they can talk to different people, and you can ask them to change, let's say, the way they talk to you in a way to become more comprehensible for you to understand what's going on. So here we are basically opening up disruptive innovation, and in which way? So this is a dashboard. This is a dashboard, for example, of a PV plant that we have at Eurac, but it's a dashboard that you could see professionally used in a control room by an asset manager of a portfolio of PV plants. So lots of beautiful plots, lots of graphs that you can see. You probably look at this with interest on day one, on day two, and then you start ignoring it because you have way too many information. So at the end, what you are really interested in just when you get some warning. What about if we bypass completely this dashboard? What about if you have a PV plant on your roof and you know nothing about the technology? Typically, you put your PV plant on the roof, maybe they give you an app, They give you access to the app. And through this app, you're meant to understand if the PV plant is working properly or not. You're excited, you look at the app on day one, you show it to your friends, and then you forget about the existence of the app. What about if you can use tools that you use on your daily life, like Telegram or WhatsApp, to completely bypass the dashboard and ask in to the AI, to large language models, simple question like, how is my PV system performing today? So the idea here is that you leverage on widespread use of existing apps. So you are not looking into yet another app. You replace complex dashboards with intuitive chat interfaces. And this will be a very disruptive and cost-effective transition. So this is a beta version that we have running already at Eurac. So you ask a question like, how is the generation of my system? So it answers back to you. You can even send a vocal message and it will answer back to you. And you can say, look, I'm not an expert. Can you please tell me by using a traffic light system? And the AI will say, yeah, but what about if green means all good and red, there is an issue? You answer, okay. And then from then on, the system will provide that type of information. You can use emoticons, whatever is good for you. So you can imagine that this can have a massive impact to people who own a PV system, but they don't really understand how they work or how to interpret the complicated dashboards or the apps that they show you very nice profiles, but it means probably nothing to you. So to get towards the conclusion of my talk, so we are going to witness a significant leap in AI application within the PV industry. These advancements, they promise to increase efficiency and automation, but we believe they represent a fundamental transformation in how solar energy is monitored, managed, and distributed. So to summarize, we can have disruptive concept in dashboards and beyond. So really imagine companies that they entirely rely, their product is based on dashboards. What they probably need to start thinking about a plan B in some cases. Predictive maintenance can be revolutionized, and the entire workflow can be, entire framework can be run by AI. And finally, just I asked AI to, in this case was Bing with DALL-E. I asked, give me a picture of a control room of a PV plant. And the question is this person still needed in the future? So do we still need people in front of computer looking for deviation and warnings and manually send, let's say, information to other operators to go in the field, or can it be entirely driven by AI? I believe the vast majority of the steps can really be driven by AI. Final slides to show you how all of this is perceived by the industry. 2 months ago, I have given a similar presentation to a room in Barcelona at the Solar Quality Summit. So it was a room full of people working in the sector. And we asked 2 simple questions. So the first one was, in 3 years' time, do you see a strong use of AI in the solar sector? And the majority of people answered yes, strong role. What to me was a little bit strange is that in the question, will AI be a threat for your job? 56% said no. I'm happy for them that they don't feel it as a threat. But I have the feeling that this has been underestimated. But this is just my feeling. And with this, I would like just to invite you to think that we really need new specialists to be able to manage AI. So maybe the role of data scientists will disappear because it will be taken over by AI. But the, let's say, specialists to create the AI which will make data scientists disappear will be ready, will be needed. So you just need to shift maybe your interest from data science to AI-based data science. I would like to acknowledge my colleagues who are actively working in this field. And with this, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Yeah, thank you very much for your presentation. We already have here a question from Davide, but everyone, you're welcome to either ask your question here in the chat, or you can also unmute yourself and ask your question directly. Here, a person, first of all, thank you very much for your presentation. To my knowledge, correct me, Frong LLM relies on large data sets concerning solar plants. For example, are data sets already available and shared by owners and companies? And is there any effort in this direction in industry or in the scientific community? And how are data gathered?
Yeah, this is a nice question. So no, it's not shared by owners and by companies. We are in Trust PV, for example, we have managed to create an environment for the partners of the project to share data, but this was limited within the project itself. So it's true that in the ideal scenario, it would be nice to really have all this data shared and find common knowledge. But at the moment, we didn't manage to find the right framework to convince people to do so. This is a little bit of a challenge itself to make sure that people feel comfortable and they see the added value of sharing their own data, because of the competitors are sharing their own data and so on. What we managed to do, for example, in ticketing, so in field inspections, we have managed to collect more than 150,000 tickets at the moment that we are using to let's say calculate, estimate the economic impact of, let's say, issues in the field and so on. But yeah, so there are several efforts going in this direction. To my knowledge, none of this effort has been particularly successful. Maybe it's worth mentioning that we are exploring now the use of differential privacy and federative learnings to make sure that people feel comfortable, so companies feel comfortable in sharing the data, because the data itself will stay private, but the knowledge will become common.
Thank you for your answer. Does anyone still have any other questions?
Maybe the question that, I don't know, there are, how many people are connected? I think around
33.
I see that there is a raised
In general. Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
Yeah, please, otherwise, you can ask
otherwise
your question.
I would like to ask then if maybe they can put in the chat if they, well, I guess the participants, I don't know if they have a job at the moment or not, but how many of them are interested in pursuing a career in AI would be interesting to see.
Yeah, definitely. If you heard the question, please, you can just write the answer here in the chat box.
We need to unmute the participant with the raised hands.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, thank you so much. Very nice presentation. My name is Mominul. I'm working at the University of Flensburg in Germany. So they're very, very insightful, and what is the insightful presentation and what we can see in the future, that is very interesting. But the question is about how are we going to maintain the security of the system? For example, definitely we are digitizing everything. That is, we have to do it eventually with the trend. At the same time, how do we ensure the security because of this? For example, I have a system and somebody just turned it off, you know, like just logging it in and turned it off or doing something else. So energy security point of view, how far it is to in the research that how robust the security going to be in the future to prevent any kind of outages or misuse of my system by someone else.
Mm-hmm. No, very, very, very interesting point. I don't have a definite answer. Let's say it will become especially an issue when we start having PV together with batteries, and when even in the centralized system, not only in centralized system, the system can actuate and react to, let's say, price signal, for example, and so on. So this is something that is already happening, but in the future it will happen even more. So you're absolutely correct. Someone could access our system, they could switch it off. Let's say compared to doing something like that in nuclear power plant or in hydropower plants, the worst that can happen is that my solar system will go down, and then of course we will have some blackouts. But let's say there is no other related hazards related to that, like it could happen, for example, in other type of generation sources. But this is, of course, is not enough. So in parallel to, let's say, the digitalization of the assets and the fact that these assets can be controlled remotely, like inverters of a PV plant or a power plant controller, it's important that cybersecurity is taken seriously. So the providers of power plant controller, for example, they can be controlled remotely, they already have in place fully fledged state-of-the-art cybersecurity solutions to make sure that if there is any attempt to hack into their system, this can be detected on time. So let's say the industry is getting ready for it. But you're right, it's a very, very important aspect. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Here we also have a question from Asha. What are the first recommendations to those? She said yes to your question that she does work in the AI field. And what are your recommendations to those who don't have an AI background?
So, wait a second. Let's see if we can.
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Okay, my recommendation would be not to ignore it to start with. I mean, you don't have to become an expert, but my experience so far is that if I look in my team, for example, I think even if not all of them are experts in AI, they are all actively using AI tools of some sort. So they are embracing, they got the right spirit. They say, okay, AI is here to stay, so we might as well look, we might as well try to understand where it works well, where it doesn't work well, where it's reliable, where it's not. So my first suggestion would really be to let's say, curious about it, not just, put it aside as a buzzword. And the second thing, maybe this comes unexpected, is that top management, maybe I'm generalizing too much, but my feeling is that top management are really underestimating the impact of AI. So they didn't start look at them themselves. And I believe it's only when you start playing around with ChatGPT, just having a simple conversation about whatever, when you fully understand what we are dealing with. So if you never played around with that, it's also difficult to explain where is the revolution. So my simple recommendation would be curious and try a few things. Also ask yourself the ethical aspects of it. Make sure that you really understand the implication of using AI, of not using AI, and the ethical implication. Yeah, that would be my very basic recommendation.
We also have here a question from Bastian. He says, thank you for the talk. And what is your experience with the reliability of Asian models for solving specific tasks?
This is to be good, very good question. And hopefully in the future, I will be able to come with a definite answer. So the two people I acknowledged before, they are actively working on it. I'm beta testing and playing around. And what I learned is I think this is a common term in AI, they hallucinate quite a lot. Not my colleagues, the AI agents. Meaning that, I'll give you an example, even if they don't have access, for example, to real-time data, they try to make you happy and they say, yes, I do have access to real-time data. And then you ask, are you really sure that you have access to? And then they start saying, oh, sorry for the miscomprehension. That's not what I meant. So a lot needs to be improved in terms of the reliability of the agent. But if you think that the revolution started 1 year ago, and where we are now, I think this can be solved in the near future. Yeah.
Is there a prediction as to when it would be widely used, for example, in the solar field?
Look, the interesting part is that the companies I mentioned before, for example, companies that they provide service like monitoring and something like that, they know that for them it could represent a big challenge. They are already working on introducing AI in their workflow. I think at the moment, two scenarios could happen. One of them will make the first step, and then everyone will follow, or you will have someone coming from a completely different sectors, not active in the field yet, but starting from AI. Instead of taking something that you already have and you update it with the use integrating AI, you will have someone coming from the AI sector, embracing the solar sector with a product that will be a completely new thought since the beginning, in a completely different way, and that could be a revolution again. So I don't know, very hard to tell. I mean, if you think what happened really in the last year, I would say that probably in 2 years' time, there will be some elements of AI in every single aspect of the solar sector.
Mm-hmm. And it's true. I think there will be a lot of companies starting based on AI, and then they're selling a product. Exactly. That would be interesting to see.
Yeah.
Do you have any other questions? Please feel free to ask them in the chat box or to unmute yourself.
Yeah, there was a direct question as a direct message, so I will answer. So is that which roles could disappear? I think the data scientist, pure data scientist, that I don't know, they take some scripts in Python and they analyze some data. I think they are at risk. I'm also thinking about anyone who is involved in manual workflow that could be easily, let's say, taken over by AI. So, but the point here is really is I'm positive. So I'm not saying that these people, they will lose the job. They will have more time available to do something more useful than that. So let's look at it from a positive point of view.
Or they will have to embrace, more artificial intelligence, like monitoring it, basically, or just have to understand it better, basically. We had an interesting question here that just disappeared from Victoria.
I think it was sent directly. So it's the cost, the impact of generative AI on the cost. So we are Looking into that, I cannot give you a ballpoint figure right now, but based on, for example, on the on our how much we are paying for the subscription of the services, so it's probably less expensive than we thought it would be. And then it depends. You know, all the reports that I show it to you, because you pay by page or by word or by character, then you just need to make sure that it's not too verbose. So you can always say, don't talk too much, because you cost me money if you write too much. But yeah, it's something that I cannot tell you right now. Typically, when the measure is in services during operation maintenance is euros per kilowatt per year, it would be nice to give you a figure like that. We know how much it should not cost, that's for sure. So there are target values. I would say that if you start costing more than 1 euros per kilowatt per year, then I don't know, it will be difficult for AI to make a breakthrough. But we believe it should cost less than that, yeah.
Do we have any final questions?